couple of minutes on this. I actually posted two things, and I believe I sent them both to your mtmail.mtsu.edu and the D2L e-learn, whatever it is, as well as posted under the announcements at the D2L website. Two things. You've got the exam, and you've got this handout, Sherman's Suggestions Requirements for Successful Papers. Let me talk about the exam first. I'm not going to give your quizzes back because I don't have them done. And we probably won't, we might, but we probably won't finish High King on Tuesday, so I'm going to push the quiz for this back to Thursday of next week. If you guys are anything like my first class, we'll only get through about the first 80 pages. So hopefully we'll be able to finish it on Tuesday. So the exam. I'm not going to read all of this, but I am going to read the five topics you get to choose from. Okay? Now, one of the important things to note about this is the items that are included in bold. Okay? For example, you must have a direct substantive quotation from at least five of the seven works we have read, and you must include a works cited page. If you have a direct substantive quotation from four of the works, well done, you get an F. Okay? Because that's not five. If you don't meet the minimum requirements, you get an F. Okay? But each of the topics also have comments about quotations. Okay? So follow the directions. Here's the first topic. You have to choose one. And this is due a week from today. In his essay, Tolkien claims fairy stories, i.e. fantasy literature, offers to adult readers fantasy escape, recovery, and consolation. In what ways do A Wrinkle in Time and The Chronicles of Prydain offer adult readers recovery? How do these novels help us to see the world as we are meant to see it? In your response, notice I'm telling you here, quote from the essay, Tolkien's definition of recovery, so you're going to quote from the essay, and then include quotations from A Wrinkle in Time and at least three Prydain novels. So the essay, Wrinkle in Time, and at least three. I don't care which three. Any of the three. Don't include three from one and none from any others. Okay? Quotations from at least three. Yes?
I'm looking at the one that you posted on D2L.
Yeah, I haven't fixed it yet.
Oh, okay. Just making sure.
I just fixed the previous classes. I'll fix this one within about an hour after class. I'll get it remove the other one and post the new ones. Okay? So that's the first one. Two, in his essay, Tolkien writes, for creative fantasy is founded upon the hard recognition that things are so in the world. Stop calling me when I don't know who you are. The things are so in the world as it appears under the sun, upon a recognition of fact, but not a slavery to it. Unquote. Referring to the essay, to explain the quotation, here's one quote, and to A Wrinkle in Time and three of the Prydain novels, there's your other four minimum, explain how they show, quote, things in the world as it appears under the sun, unquote, but also how the characters choose not to be enslaved to those facts, but try to change them. A little bit harder. Number three, discuss the theme of sacrifice in A Wrinkle in Time and the Chronicles of Prydain. Be specific in your references to sacrificial acts. Not only quote such passages from the novels, but comment on and explain them. Notice that when I've not said a number of quotations from The Wrinkle in Time or Chronicles of Prydain, because at the top of here, it tells you this one governs everything, and then there are sub-requirements down here. If the sub-requirements don't explain, then you go by this one. You must have at least quotations from five of the seven works we have read. So if you're quoting once from A Wrinkle in Time, you need quotations from four of the Chronicles of Prydain. Okay? Applying a little logic here. Number four, in what ways are these novels, A Wrinkle in Time, wait, did I do that? Yeah. In what ways are these novels, A Wrinkle in Time and The Chronicles of Prydain, about the process of maturation, about growing up? What does the process of growing up entail? What is the goal, so to speak, of growing up? Again, Wrinkle in Time, and then that's going to require quotations from four different Chronicles of Prydain. Okay? And then the last one. In the course of the novels, A Wrinkle in Time and The Chronicles of Prydain, what life lessons do Meg and Taryn learn? So, Chronicles of Wrinkle in Time, at least one quotation. Chronicles of Prydain, at least one quotation from four separate books. Okay? On the last three, that's what you have to have. Okay? Those are minimum. Can you have more? Yes. You've only got roughly 750 to 1,000 words, though. So you don't want to go all crazy in the number of quotations, because you don't want your paper to be mostly quotation. Generally speaking, papers you write ought to be papers you write. Okay. I know it sounds radical. What does that mean? Minimum, pretty much minimum, about 75% of the words ought to be your words. Maybe 25% borrowed, quoted from your sources. Even that's a little heavy, 25%. Now, I stipulate the quotations need to be substantive. Yes is not a substantive quotation. Four words is not a substantive quotation. Unless it's, can I say that? Yeah, we'll get there. Unless it's something like The King of Mona is Dead. It's five, but, okay? That would be substantive, depending on how you use it, okay? But just a one or two or three or even five-word quotation isn't really substantive. I mean, we're talking a sentence or more, okay? Then you have this, okay? This applies not just for your midterm paper, but also the longer paper you will write for the class and your final exam. This is pretty much all about citing your sources and your works cited page, documenting your sources, how to include quotations. You can be really boring and just say Alexander writes every time you quote from Alexander. And then have, in the parenthetical citation, the various book. Because you can't just say Alexander writes dot 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 quotation dot 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 39. Why can't you? Bingo. You're not telling me which book. I got a doctoral thesis I had to do this to. Okay? You gotta tell me which. He's got five novels written by him. I should not have to, and believe me, I won't. I should not have to pull out all five books and try to figure out where that quote's coming from. Because, yes, I will check some of the quotations. Not all of them, some of them. Okay. So, if you do this, you need to have some abbreviated form, and that handout talks about that, of the title here. Cauldron, King, Taryn, Castle, Book. You can use those. Okay. I probably wouldn't say three, but Castle of Lear, Taryn the Wanderer, you can use Wanderer, High King, you probably don't want to use High, but you are, in which case, do whatever. follow the guidelines on here about what you put on the first page, and at the bottom, I tell you what the beginning of your first page should look like. Okay. If you can't follow this, you really shouldn't be here. I'm being just, you know, brutally honest here. Go flip burgers or something. Go do something else, because you're wasting your time and money, not just mine. And the way I'll grade this, like I said at the beginning of class, first thing I'll do is I'm going to look at your works cited page. Do you have, what is it? At least five of the separate works. If you don't, there's your grade. F. Okay? If you don't have a title, you get one. F. That makes it real easy for me, because I don't have to grade it. So if you want to make my life easy, don't follow directions. Okay? Any questions real quickly? Yes, Ron.
Will we get knocked if we go over 1,000 words?
Depends on how much. If you have, you know, 1,050, probably not. If you start going over 1,100, yeah. No, you won't get docked while I take off, you know, 1.2 points for every word. I don't grade by points like that. It's kind of a holistic thing, okay? If you've got a great paper, idea-wise, content-wise, but the writing is full of all kinds of grammatical errors, you're going to have an F. Because you can't have a great paper, content-wise, if it's full of grammatical errors. Similarly, if you've got a great paper that doesn't have any grammatical errors, but the content is crap, probably won't be an F, but probably won't be much better than that. D or C, okay? Because usually, if it doesn't have any grammatical or writing problems, it's also going to have good ideas. I mean, usually the two go together, okay? Last thing about all this. What is a thesis? Okay, main point you're trying to make. Okay. Well, it could be. What's another word for thesis? Other than point.
Conclusion.
Nope, it's not the conclusion. What do you mean by idea?
What you're trying to get across.
Keep going.
Your argument.
A thesis is an argument. Right? Everybody likes to argue. That's what your thesis is. Right? It is your argument with me. Okay? Now, these are artificial arguments. I've designed them for you. Okay? But your thesis needs to be strongly worded. It can't be some little limp-wristed, pasty, namby-pamby thing, all right? What should a thesis do? Let me put it this way. Immigration. Do any of you have any doubts whatsoever what Donald Trump thinks about immigration? No. Why not?
He's made it
very clear. Your thesis ought to do the very same. It ought to reach out, grab your reader, smack him across the face a couple times. So that I don't have to sit there and go, I wonder what they mean. I wonder what the point is. Because if I have to say, I don't know what your thesis is, that's not good. Because that usually means you don't have one. And you're becoming, I have the right book pulled out, like Taryn, wandering. That means there's a lot of wandering going on up. There are dust, cobwebs up here, rather than laser-like focus on the idea, okay? So you come up with that idea, you word it strongly. You don't put thesis before your thesis. You don't put your thesis in a different font. You don't put it in a different color. It ought to be clear to me what it is, okay? So make it strong. Have several kind of points to that so that you can then respond. Okay, so you have your thesis. Then how do you prove your point? How do you win an argument when you get in an argument with a friend?
Back it up with facts.
Back it up with facts. Yeah, but what are facts?
Your quotations.
When you write this paper, you're like a lawyer in a courtroom. And you come up and you say, Your Honor, I'd like to admit as evidence, point one, first quotation. You've all watched a law show, some kind of legal show, or maybe been involved with the law yourself, as I know some of you have. Does a lawyer just say, I'd like to admit into evidence, you know, Exhibit A? And then go and sit down. What's the point of that exhibit? What does the lawyer then do? Delves into it. Discusses its relevance. So, when you quote from the novel, what do you need to do right after that? Okay, and I have to tell doctoral students this. You explain it. You show its relevance to
the thesis.
You go all the way back to the thesis. Every paragraph supports the thesis. Every paragraph reinforces that. Each one of those paragraphs is like a nail in the lid of a coffin. You're sealing that sucker up so that whatever's inside can't get out. Or you're proving your point. Okay? Okay. Enough on that. Pulled out these other two books for what reason? That's why. Because we never talked about or I never said anything about the author's note. And I kind of think it's important for Book of Three and the Black Cauldron to at least just point these out. The Book of Three, first one. Alexander writes, the Chronicle of, and I know you don't have them with you, so don't worry about it. The Chronicle of Prydain is a fantasy. Such things never happen in real life. Right? Do you know any old white guy with a long beard who has a book called the Book of Three that if you touch it burns your fingers? Probably not.
I know a couple of Gurgis.
Yeah. Gurgis are all around us, man. Prince Runes, all around us. Alonwes, yes. Prince Gwydion's, not so much. Or do they? That is, or do these things never happen in life? Most of us are called on to perform tasks far beyond what we can do. Our capabilities seldom match our aspirations, and we are often woefully underprepared. Now, some of you are probably thinking, woefully underprepared. You're not. To this extent, we are all assistant pig keepers at heart. Now, I should have started with that. Because what's he saying? We are Terran. You know, I am Groot. I am Terran. Okay? First one. Second one from the Black Cauldron. Although an imaginary world, Prydain is essentially not too different from our real one, where humor and heartbreak, joy and sadness are closely interwoven. The choices and decisions that face a frequently baffled assistant pig keeper are no easier than the ones we ourselves must make. Even in a fantasy realm, growing up is accomplished not without cost. Okay? High King. He says, I must, however, warn readers of this fifth chronicle to expect the unexpected. Its structure is somewhat different, its range wider. If there is more external conflict, I've tried to add more inner content. If the form follows that of the traditional hero tale, the individuals, I hope, are genuinely human. And although it deals with a battle on an epic scale, where Terran, Princess Ilanwe, Fluterflam, even the oracular pig Henwin, are pressed to the limits of their strength, it is a battle whose aftermath is deeper in consequences than the struggle itself. What does he mean? Okay, I need to ask this. Has anybody finished it? One or two. Okay, so remind me. Shut my mouth. Because a couple times in my first class, I almost gave away some pretty important things. And I had one person say, stop. So I did. Okay? Well, we can generalize about that. What does he mean? The aftermath is more significant than the battle itself. Some of you have been in the military. I've had friends who were in the military, family members who were in the military, friends who were in some pretty nasty firefights, and they'll be the first ones to tell you. What they go through afterwards is nothing compared. Or excuse me, is everything compared to what they went through in the 5 hours of the actual firefight. Okay? The final choice, which even faithful Gergi cannot avoid, is almost too hard to bear. He's talking about the last chapter. So if you haven't got to it, you don't know what he's talking about. Fortunately, it is never offered to us in the real world. At least not in such unmistakable terms. In other words, it is offered to us, but just not as clearly as it is here. It's not as black and white as it is here. Okay? Whether the assistant pig keeper chose well, whether the ending is happy, heartbreaking, or both, decide for yourselves. So, where did Terran Wanderer finish? What happened at the end of that novel? Or where was Terran at the end of Terran Wanderer? Had he actually begun traveling home? He was still with Anlaw Clayshaker. Anlaw, you know, said, so what'd you learn, if you don't mind asking? And he told them, what did he see when he looked in the mirror of Luna? Saw myself. Pride? Yep. Humility? Little. Arrogance? Lot. Okay. Good intentions? Yes. But a lot more I'd left unfinished. Vanity? Yep. He says, I saw myself as all men would see themselves. Full of these kinds of contrasts. Okay? Some good, some evil. But he also says, I also saw myself as separate, unique individual. I am Terran, nothing else. What does he mean by the nothing else? I am not Gwydion. I'm not Fluter. I'm not Rune. I'm not Kahl. I'm not Dalbin. I'm not Gergi. I'm not Akron. I'm not Alanwi. I'm not Smoit. I'm not Aiden. I'm not Craddock. I'm not Ponio. I'm not Drudwas. I'm not Lassar. I am what? Me. Me. I am me. That's it. Only problem is he doesn't really know what me is. Okay? What did he go off searching for? His parentage. He thought that would tell him who he was. Notice, did he discover anything about his parents? No. He never learns whether or not he is of noble or base birth, how he terms it. Okay. He does learn some things about himself, however. What are some of the things he learns? What does he learn to do, for example? Okay, he does learn about honor. How?
Nobles are necessarily noble.
Okay. How else?
Learns how to take care of himself.
Learns how to take care of himself. He learns how to forge a sword. He learns how to weave a cloak. He learns how to make a clay dish. What else does he do? He learns how to marshal troops. He learns how to cultivate land with his bare hands. He learns how to deal with death on a very personal level when Craddock dies. Okay. And he learns how to confront who he is when he looks in that mirror. All the warts and faults that there are. Okay? So, having learned all of that, he's now on his way back. And with Gergi, and Kahl returns, and Kahl says, page 4, I love me, Princess, are we? And Terran, you know, that's pedal to the metal, man. He's. Okay? And he gets back to Cair Dalbin, page 5. And she says, I've been waiting to see you for days. After all the time, I've been away learning to be a young lady, as if I weren't one before I left. When I'm home at last, you're not even here. And he's kind of like, oh, sorry. And then she kind of stops. She pushes back away from him. And she looks at him. This is bottom of page 5. Alanwi stopped abruptly and looked curiously. That's odd. There's something different about you, she says. It's not your hair, though. It's not your hair, though it does look as if you'd cropped it yourself with your eyes shut. Well, there's a nice little comment. Like, you know, Stevie Wonder took cheers to him. It's, well, I can't quite say. I mean, unless you told someone, they'd never guess you were an assistant pig keeper. What does she mean? Okay, he's grown up. What does that mean? How?
She can tell how he saw the wedding for the first time, how he was not like this beautiful looking kind of time, how he's got looks of age to him, like he's been through some stuff.
Okay, so is it just physical? Okay.
How he carries himself is different too.
His demeanor, his behavior, how he carries himself is different. Yeah, he's okay, but maturity means a bunch of different things. That's why, you know, the question, dealing with maturation and growing up. It's not about physical size. Has Taryn grown up that way? Yeah, he has. He's also gained in size. But she's looking at him like, what does she mean when she says, if someone had never seen you before, they'd never know you were an assistant pig keeper. How does an assistant pig keeper look? Okay, is that what is she talking about? You're not dirty anymore. You don't smell like pig, you know what? That's not what she means. An assistant pig keeper is what? Assistant. Does Taryn look like he's assistant to anyone? No, he's his own man now. He is no longer servant to anyone else. He's no longer got to prove something to anyone else. It's in that air about him, that quality. Does he, and we're never told this before, does he walk kind of hunched over, stooped shoulders? No, he stands up straight. He knows who he is. He knows what he can do. He knows if Kara Dalbin were to disappear, he could do what? He could stand on his own. He can make his way. Taryn laughs and says, it's been a long time since I tended Henwin. And he says, you know, and in fact, during my whole time wandering, I never tended any pigs. What's he saying? I'm not an assistant pig keeper anymore, you stupid girl. No, it's not what he's saying. He says, this cloak I wove at the loom of Dwivak, the weaver woman. This sword, Hevet the smith, taught me the forging of it. And this, and he pulls out of his saddlebag, or out of his jacket, the earthen bowl that he made. This I made at the wheel on La Clayshaper. If it pleases you, it is yours. Notice, he doesn't just say, here, you can have it. Why not? Here you can have it is, I don't really care whether you like it or not. I made this for you. It's yours. Take it. Okay? She says, it's lovely. Yes, I shall treasure it. For her, it becomes a treasure. But that's what I mean. I'm not saying you aren't a good assistant pig keeper because I'm sure you're the best in Prydain. You are, let's put it in kind of words he would understand, you're the king of assistant pig keepers. No, there's something more. Call. You speak truth, princess. He left us a pig keeper and comes back looking as if he could do all he set his hand to, comma, whatever. What does he mean? When he left, or let's back up. Beginning of the first book. What could Taryn do? Wash the pig. Could he forge a horseshoe? No, he could not. Could he forge a sword? Much less than a horseshoe. Okay. He learns a little bit in the course of that novel. But still, even at the beginning of the previous book, which is where Call is talking about, he's still just an assistant pig keeper. Yeah, he helped rescue the princess from the Castle of Lear and all that. But now he looks like he could do all he set his hand to. That is, nothing is beyond his ability. He could learn. He could force himself. Taryn, no, not true. He corrects Call. I learned I was neither swordsmith nor weaver. Yet he's made a pretty damn good sword. He's woven a fairly good coat. Nor, alas, a shaper of clay. He says, Gergi, we were already on our way home when Call found us. So he's learned a whole bunch of stuff, but he's learned, I'm not a potter, I'm not a weaver, I'm not a swordsmith, I'm not a smith. Right? Now Langley says, well, I'm glad you were on your way back. Someone told me that you'd gone off to find your father, or you'd found a father you didn't know, or he found a son. I'm not quite sure. Taryn, there's little to understand. Bottom of six. What I sought, I found, though it's not what I hoped. What did he hope?
No matter who's president.
Mom and dad were king and queen. Queen and king. Okay? They weren't cross-dressing king and queens. Not what I hoped. But he did find what he sought what he found. So, was he really seeking his parentage? He says, I found what I was looking for. What was he looking for?
Identity.
Yeah. Who am I? Who am I? Why am I here? What is my purpose? All issues philosophers have been dealing with for thousands of years. Okay. And theologians and others. Dalbin, no, it's not what you'd hoped for. You found more than you sought and gained perhaps more than you know. In other words, Dalbin's kind of going back to, no, you sought your parents, but you found a whole lot more than that. And in fact, you gained, you took away from that wandering more than you were even aware of. I still don't see why you wanted to leave. Because, you know, she didn't like being off at Mona. And Rune comes in. And Terence calls him Prince Rune, page 7. King Rune, actually, he corrects him, since my father died last summer. Terence hadn't heard. That's one of the reasons why Princess Elanwe is here now. My mother wanted to keep her with us on Mona to finish her education. And you know my mother... She'd never have left off with it, even though Dalbin had sent word Ilanwe was to come home. In other words, even though Dalbin said, send Ilanwe home, Mother said no. He said, so I finally put my foot down. I ordered the ship fitted out. Off we sail. Amazing what a king can do when he sets his mind to it. Does he mean king? I mean, yes, literally, he means king because that's the word he uses. What else does he mean, though? Man. Does he mean just man or woman, too? I think he means both. Okay? Amazing what a person can do. What? When they put their mind to it. Because all too often we're confronted with things, right? In real life. And we say, I can't do that. And yet you have to. I can't write an 8-page paper. And you do. Or you're going to graduate school. I can't write a 50-page paper or a 100-page or a 300-page dissertation. And you know, at the end of a process of a year, guess what? You've done it. Okay? How do you do it? What's the old adage about, you know, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. Might take a long time. One bite at a time. Okay? So Rune also points out, they've got glue with them. We're going to skip all that talk about glue. Page 9. Call's explaining where Fluter and the others are. Because Taryn's like, oh, if only Fluter and Dahl and Gwydion, Call and Dahl and Dolly and Gwydion were here, it'd be like happy times. It'd be like old times. Okay? Three of our companions are missing, he says, bottom of page 8. Good old Dolly, Fluter Flam, and I'd hope Princess Gwydion might have come to welcome Ilanwe. Call. Dolly sends his wishes. but we'll have to do without his company. As for Flute or Flam, nothing could keep him in his heart from any merrymaking or whatever. He should have been here long since. What does that he should have been here long since introduce? Something's wrong. Daubin, Prince Gwydion as well. He and I have matters to discuss. Though you young people may doubt it, some of them are even weightier than the homecomings of a princess and an assistant pig keeper. Okay. So, Arlan, he takes off her crown, says, I don't want to worry about this anymore. And she pulls out from her cloak something she has made. So she's not the only person who's made something during the intervening year. Taryn has his cloak, his sword, his piece of pottery. She pulls out a piece of embroidery. And she gives it to Taryn. Why? One, she made it for him. And two, what was she doing while she made it? Thinking of him. And it's a picture, an embroidery of Henwin. And she says, originally it had you on it, but you looked like a stick figure with a nest on your head. So I took that out. Top of 10, she says, at first I tried to embroider you into it, and she explains why. You'll just have to make believe you're standing beside her, a little to the left. Taryn, if I was in your thoughts then, your work gladdens me all the more. No matter that Hen's eyes are really brown. Okay, what has he just done? It's not quite right, you know. Her eyes aren't blue. You don't really like it? She says, I do in all truth. Brown or blue makes no difference. It will be useful. You dolt. It's not supposed to be useful. It's a keepsake, not a horse blanket. Taryn says it will be useful. He doesn't have any idea how this thing's going to be useful. But when we get to the second half of the novel, we're going to see. It becomes his battle flag. It becomes the standard that rides into battle beside him. Taryn of the White Pig, you know, kind of like what it is. Not quite as, you know, terrifying as the red rampant lion or dragon, you know, but. Not even a boar with the tusk, right, but, you know. Okay. So, she makes a comment about, you know, that Taryn probably forgot the color of her eyes. Page 10, very bottom, he says, not so, princess. Nor have I forgotten when you gave me this. Its powers are greater than either of us knew. They are gone now, but I treasure it still because it came from your hand. You asked why I sought to know my parentage? Because I hoped it would prove noble and give me the right to ask what I dare not ask before. My hope was mistaken. Yet even without it, and he doesn't get to ask!
Yeah.
Because Flute or Flam shows up at that point with Gwydion on his back. And they think he's dead, or at least Ilanwe does, bottom of page 11. Taryn says he lives, though barely. Fetch medicines, he orders to Gurgi. The healing herbs are my saddlebags. And then he kind of stops, catches himself. Sorry, Dolphin. Sorry, this is your house. Forgive me, it is not for me, he says, to command under my master's roof. But the herbs are of great power. Adeon, son of Taliesin, gave them to me long ago. They are yours if you wish them. Dolphin, I know their nature. Have none that will serve better. That is, I know what you have, and I don't have anything that's more useful. Nor should you fear to command under, notice he doesn't say under my roof. He says under any roof, since you have learned to command yourself. I trust your skill as I see you trust it. Do as you see fit. What does he mean with that clause? Since you have learned to command yourself. Okay, you're mature now. What else? Okay, but what does he mean specifically by since you have learned to command yourself? The command yourself, two meanings. You have learned to command others. How? How? He learned, Dobbin says, to command yourself. How did he learn it? Take the L off. He earned it. How did he earn it? He put himself to the use of the various people of the free commons. He put himself to the use of King Smoit, and what happens? He rises above King Smoit. So that Smoit says, you know, you don't need to worry about your parents. I'll be your father. You rule my kingdom after me. He learned command there. Did he tell Smoit what to do? No. He said, hey, I got a, wouldn't it be a good idea too? But by the time we get to the Kamat Marin, I think it is, where he's with Drudwas and Lassar and that little group of people, and he marshals the forces against Doroth and company, he's commanding there. Okay? So how did he learn to command others? You said it. He learned how to command himself. Meaning? What did he learn?
Temperance.
Yeah. What do we not see in Terran in the first few books? Self-control. Self-control. He flies off. He rushes. Henwin escapes. What does he do? Does he go get Call? Does he go get Dalbin? Nope. He rushes off into the exact place Call and Dalbin tell him not to go. Into the forest. So he's learned self-control. He doesn't just rush wildly. So Dobbin says, because of that, nor should you fear to command under any roof. Well, whose does that any include other than Dobbin's? Kings, Gwydion's, Math, the High King of Prydain. Okay. And he says, I trust your skill as I see you trust it. What's Dobbin saying there? Does Terran have any doubt in his abilities anymore? No, he doesn't. He is sure of himself. Why? Because he's learned throughout his travels, throughout his journeys. So, Fluter says, the huntsman of Anuvin. Two lives they almost claimed. And he looks at Terran and goes, how'd you get here? How did you escape? Terran, what? I saw you not an hour ago. Terran says, I've been here for an hour. Fluter says, eyes of a flam, you know, they never lie. No, but a flam does. He says, page 13, Lord Gwydion and I, rode together from the northern lands. We crossed Averin, we're well on our way here. He says, and I saw you with my own eyes. You were hard-pressed. You shouted to us for help. Gwydion outdistanced me. He's always going to outdistance Fluter. Okay. He said, you galloped beyond the clearing. Gwydion rode after you. By the time I got up, the huntsman had him off the saddle and such. Terran says, you saved his life. Right. And Fluter's like, if it wasn't you who called, who was it? Terran, doesn't matter, not right now. First we have to take care of Gwydion. Okay. And Ocran comes in and says, I know who it was. It was Aron. He's left his castle. And what can he do? He can take the form of anyone he wants. Okay. She says, your eyes did not play you false, Harper, page 15. You saw what was meant for you to see. Pig keeper? Why not, if thus he chose to appear? So she keeps talking. And Terran says, page 16, then all of us are lost. That is, if Aron could take the form of anyone he wants to, even Gwydion, even Dalbin, if he can look like that, Terran, then we're lost. The Lord of Anuvin can move among us as he pleases, and we are without defense against him. Now, Terran means that in one sense, probably. He can take any of our shapes, forms, and be seen as us. He could look like Fluter Flam if he wanted to. He could look like Gergi if he wanted to. So he says, if he can do that, we'll never know. Okay? But might Lloyd Alexander mean something else by he can move among us as he pleases? Beyond the merely surface level of appearance. Who is Iran lord of? He's the lord of the dead. What else? What characterizes, let's say, his rule? Think of the major conflict, the overarching conflict behind all literature. Good and evil. He's evil. Okay? So what's being suggested? Old radio show from the 1930s and 40s. Originally starred, fat guy did wine commercials, Citizen Kane.
George Orwell?
No. Did War of the World, Orson Welles. Okay. Originally starred Orson Welles as a voice, and then later on another guy named, but it began, The Shadow. It began, who knows what evil lurks in the hearts of men? The shadow knows. Okay? What evil lurks in the hearts of men? What did Terran see when he looked in the mirror of Lunet? But he saw what lurks in the hearts of all men. He saw good and evil. He saw vanity and humility. Okay? It's this that can move among all people. Okay? I'll give a little hint as to something that's going to happen in the second half of the book. A major character. Not major in the sense that we already know the person, but a major character goes evil. Completely unexpected. Everybody's pinning their hopes, essentially. And the person whoosh, does a 180. Okay? That's how, not Iran himself, but that's how Iran, okay, can move among people. So Ocran says, you have reason to fear. Now you see one of his subtlest powers. But what's the danger to Iran when he does that? What power does he have? He doesn't have any power. If he leaves his kingdom and he takes on somebody else's form and shape, he has the power of that person. So when he took on the form of Terran in the woods, what could Gwydion easily have done? If he caught him. Yeah, because Terran's no match for Gwydion. Not even now. Not even after all of his wanderings. Okay? She says, top of page 17, then can he be slain like any mortal thing? Ilan says, oh, Flute, if I'd only been with you. Iran wouldn't have deceived me no matter how much he looked at Terran. Or how much he looked like Terran. Don't tell me I couldn't have told the difference between a real assistant pigkeeper and a false one. Notice, a real assistant pigkeeper, and why does she use those terms? Why doesn't she call him Terran again? A little distancing in the second instance. No matter how much he looked like Terran, he couldn't have deceived me. Why? Keep going. It's true. It's because she loves him.
She can tell the difference by like how his demeanor is and his actions compared to Arwan.
Is that it? Is it something she sees with her eyes?
No, it's how she feels towards him.
It's something in here. Okay? And it's something we're going to be told about her later. About a way that she perceives or understands things. So, Ocran tells them about how she used to rule before the Sons of Dawn came and how Iran deceived her, stole from her. And then she offers to keep watch over Gwydion. Now, Ilan was like, not you. I'll watch you. Don't worry about Lord Gwydion. Why does Ocran want to keep watch? What does she owe him? Her life. Okay? Her life. So, Page 19. Fluter says, I can't forgive myself. I should have seen the trap instantly. Taryn, Aron worked a trick on you. Gwydion was deceived. But not I. Fluter says, aflame is keen-eyed. From the first moment, the way he sat his steed, the way, in other words, the kinds of things Lauren's talking about, he says, I can tell. The heart, bing, you know, one of the strings just, he says, well, I mean, there it goes again. Well, I mean, okay, I didn't notice the truth. The guy's perfect. And Rune says, wow, I wish I could be that sort of shape-changing myself. Kind of important. Unbelievable. I've always thought, how interesting to be a badger or an ant. I should love to know how to build as well as they do. He's talking about building up the seawall at Mona Haven. Right? But what does he mean? It'd be nice to be able to be a shape changer. What is Rune's shape here? What was Rune's shape in the Castle of Lear? What did people think of him, in other words? Fool, moron, bumbling idiot, doofus. Even when he proved himself honorable, he was still an idiot. Right? So what shape does he want to change into? Really, a badger or ant? Or from the sheep that he is into a lion or bear or wolf? They keep talking. I'm going to skip a bunch. Go on to 22. Gwydion wakes up. Dalbin's told him about what Aron did. He knows he's lost the sword. And he talks about Durnwynn's lineage, page 22, and its history. And Taryn asks, middle of 23, after all the history, well, let me back up, 22 at the bottom. Ilongwy says, I remember the old writing on the scabbard. Draw, Durnwynn, only thou of royal blood. Gwydion corrects her. Closer to its true meaning is noble worth. She says, royal blood. He says, noble worth. How can you combine the two of those with the slightly different royal birth, which Taryn thinks means, but Gwydion says it's not about birth at all. It's noble worth. Okay? So, Gwydion says, the enchantment forbade the sword to all, but those who would use it wisely and well. The flame of Durnwynn would destroy any other who sought to draw it, but the writing on the scabbard has been marred. Says the full message, nobody knows. So Taryn finally asks, do you believe Aron can uncheat the sword? Can he turn it against us? I mean, if only one of noble worth, how noble is Aron? Nah. So Ocran says, let me search for it. I know the ways, I know how to get into Anuvin, blah, 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 blah. Gwydion says, no, this isn't your task. And she says, scorn me again to your own loss. Remember, what did she offer Gwydion previously? She offered him previously, when she still ruled, controlled Spiral Castle, join with me, and together, as my consort, we will rule Prydain. Scorn me no longer, she says. Gwydion, I do not scorn you. I only urge you to accept Dalvin's protection. Okay? What did he offer her before? Life. He doesn't want her throwing her life away. Okay? So, Dalvin says, time to bring out the prophecy sticks. He brings them out, and Hinwin backs over into the enclosure. Taryn climbs in with her. Dalvin puts down a stick. Hinwin goes up. points to certain symbols. Dalvin writes them down. She runs back to the corner. Taryn coaxes her out again. She does it a second time. A third time, the stick explodes before she can even point anything out. All right? So, page, chapter 3, pages 31 and following, we hear Ocran has fled. She's gone off to Anuvin. And we also hear Dalvin say what Henwin prophesied. He says, I asked how Durnwin might be recovered. Notice, he didn't ask how Aron could be defeated, just how to recover the sword. Ask sooner mute stone and voiceless rock to speak. Well, what does that sound like? You're not going to find it. He says, that's from the first letter stick. Second letter stick said, had to be a lot of symbols on this sucker. Quenched will be Durnwind's flame, vanished its power. Night turned to noon, and rivers burn with frozen fire, ere Durnwind be regained. Notice the air means before. So Durnwind can be regained, but what has to happen? The night has to turn to noon, and rivers have to burn with fire. Frozen fire. Okay? So they sit there and they try to figure those out, and they say, well, shoot, none of this is going to work. But Gwydion says, no matter the prophecy, I've got to go after the sword. Right? Taryn says, whoa, why don't we send Kaw first? Let Kaw go to Anuvin, see what he can find out, bring word back to us. Page 33, Gwydion. You found some wisdom in your wanderings, assistant pig keeper. In other words, it's a good idea. Better than me just rushing off. Okay. But he says, I'm going to go on off to Smoid's castle. Okay. So they all decide to go with them. Ilan Wee as well. Rune's going to take Glue back to Mona. And bottom of 37 and top of 38. Taryn is going off about the various buildings at Kaer Dalvin, looking for old implements that can be used for weapons. And Kaw says, few enough of them there are. These spears have served me well as beam poles. I never hoped to use them for another purpose. The only blade I can give Gwydion is rusted from propping up one of the apple trees. He says, I don't have any helmets. So, contra what it says in the Old Testament, Kaw has done what? He's turned swords into plowshares. Now, they've got to turn plowshares back into swords. And we're going to see that in the latter half of the novel. We're going to see Taryn go someplace, and somebody says, hey, you know what? We can take pitchforks, and we can cut the tines off pitchforks, stick them on the end of rods. You got a ready-made spear. You get four spears from one pitchfork. That's a pretty good way to make a whole bunch of weapons really fast. Okay? And Kaw goes, and you, my lad, I remember a day when an assistant pigkeeper would have been all flash and fire to ride with Lord Gwydion and others. Why aren't you just champing at the bit? Take it out there with them. Now you look as glum as a frost-bitten turnip. In other words, not much use. Taryn, I myself would ride to Anuvin if Gwydion allowed me. What you say is true, old friend. For the boy I was, this would have been a bold adventure full of glory. The boy I was? Yeah, in the first book. Okay, maybe in the second book and the third book, too. This much have I learned. A man's life weighs more than glory. What does he mean? Glory in battle isn't everything, because what comes from glory in battle? Fields steeped in blood. And the price paid in blood is a heavy reckoning. He's saying, I'm not all that keen on battle anymore, or on glory. Okay? My heart is not easy. Long ago, you made your way to Anubin to rescue Henwin after she had been stolen. What chance is Gwydion alone in Aran's realm? No man is better, and Call walks off. Is he being honest? Or is he saying, see you later, have fun storming the castle, because you're dead meat. Okay? So the bottom of that page, they're making their way, and they take a pause, and they're sitting down, and Rune starts to talk about his seawall that he wants to build to make a better harbor for the people of Mona. In Terran's senses, bottom of 38, that Rune was no longer the feckless princeling he had known on the Isle of Mona. As Rune was absorbed in the task he had planned, so Terran had been caught up in his own labors at Forge, Loom, and Potter's Wheel. In other words, while Rune was learning how to be a king, because his father died the summer Terran went off. Actually, Terran had already been off that summer. So Terran had been caught up in his own labors at Forge, Loom, and Potter's Wheel. And if Rune had found manhood in ruling a kingdom, Terran had found the same in toiling among the staunch folk of the Free Commons. Well, what else did Rune find or discover in ruling a kingdom? Okay, keep going. How to be what? How to be a king. What did Terran also learn in his journeys with the people of the Free Kamats? Notice, the Free Kamats who swear allegiance to no one but the High King. He also learned a little bit about kingship. Because what does each of the Free Kamats do to Terran? Okay, they teach him, but what else? They give allegiance to him. Even in book Terran Wanderer, we see that. Okay? They allow him to set up and to marshal the troops, so to speak. He watched Rune with new affection. The King of Mona spoke on, and Terran's interest was drawn to the scratchings on the ground. And he realizes Rune has great intentions, but they went somewhat beyond his skill. Well, what is one of the things Terran realizes when he looks into the mirror of Lunet? He also had good intentions, but what else? A lot more left incomplete. Things he had thought to do, but hadn't done. And so he says, you'll have some problems if you try to build it that way, but if you put the heavier stones down here first and then you build up, Rune, quite right. You shall come to Mona, help me finish it. Okay. A little bit of foreshadowing there. So, Terran asks Gwydion, page 40. The flame of Durnwin quenched. How? What does Terran think quenched means? What does it mean to quench a fire?
Put it out.
So how do you put out the flame of Durnwin? How do you put out a sword? You destroy it. You break it. You stop it from fulfilling its purpose. Okay? How, he says, can Aran do this? For all his power, I will not believe he can even draw the blade. Gwydion, prophecy is more than words that shape it. Okay. What does he mean? The words that shape it. Prophecy is more than the words that reveal the prophecy. Because what do words, all words do? Every word that you know It describes or it means something. Okay? In modern American English, we ascribe a meaning to the word bottle. The word bottle never means this. Why? Because we all agree it doesn't mean this. It means this. Okay? The word book means this, but it will never mean this unless we all agree at some point it means this. Okay? So notice what he's suggesting. Old English. There's a line in Beowulf that occurs three times. That was good king. Okay? It means that was a good king. But in order to translate it as that was a good king, you have to understand what it means first. Okay? Because there's a lot of other words you could use here. Good can mean more than good. Good can mean more than good. It can mean brave. It can mean splendid. It can mean courageous. It can mean honorable. So which one do you use? That was a good king is a lot different than that was a brave king, or that was a courageous king, or that was an honorable king. Okay? So, Gwydion goes on. Hinwin's prophecy is disheartening, far from what I'd hoped. But when prophecies give... When prophecies give no help, men must find it of themselves. Sorry, front page, book turn. Prophecy is more than words that shape it, Gwydion says. Seek the meaning that underlies it. What does it mean beneath the actual words? For us, the flame of Durnwin will be as good as quenched if Aran keeps it from my hands. The sword will be no good. What? If I can't hold it. So how can Aran quench it? Lock it up. Keep it away from me. Is it destroyed? No. Does that mean somebody in the future might not be able to get it? No. It just means as long as it's kept from me, it's quenched. Notice, first of all, what Gwydion is assuming there. Only I'm the one of noble worth who can use it. Okay? Its power will indeed vanish for all it may avail us should the blade be locked forever in his treasure hoard. And Glue hears that word, treasure. Who's got treasure? I don't think I'll go off to the Isle of Mona. I'm going to stick with you guys. Okay? Because they talk about treasure. So they go off to Smoid's castle. But before they do, the group splits up. Taryn, Gwydion, Call go off to Smoid's castle. Where do Fluter, Ilanwi, and Glue go? To the harbor. Because they're going to take Glue back to Mona. But Glue decides, I don't want to go to Mona. But they've already divided. Okay? So Gwydion, Taryn, Call, Gurgi go into Smoit's hall, and we're told, page 45, they are flanked by the guards as they're walking down the hall. To the great hall, to the eating hall, essentially. And who do they see? Meg. Okay. Dressed in Smoit's finery. And we're told about Meg, page 47, after he calls himself mightier than the Prince of Dawn, you know, right-hand man to Ocran, to Aran and all this. We're told his face had gone livid and his eyes started from their sockets. His hands were trembling. What's wrong with Meg? Is he just angry? Replace the last two letters of his name. He's mad. Not angry mad. Crazy. Out of his gourd. Okay. Possessed. Not demonically possessed. What's he possessed with? No. Closer. How much power does he want? Is Aran's power enough for him? No. Yeah, he's thinking, and once I get more power, I'm going to off Aran, and it'll all be mine. Okay? So, Taryn, Gurgi, Call, Gwydion get locked up with Smoit, and The others make their way back. As they're making their way back, they hear Taran blow his horn. About middle of the day, this is, you got to go back in time. Because Taran blows his horn because he wants to make sure Fluter knows where to go. Because Fluter didn't meet up where they were supposed to. Taran's a little worried. Gwydion's like, yeah, don't worry about it, it'll be okay. Okay. They get to the outskirts of Smoit's castle. And they're standing there kind of on a hillside looking down at the castle. And Ilonwy frowns, page 55. Looking at the fluttering standard of King Smoit. She says, that's odd. I see Smoit's jolly old bear, but Gwydion surely must be there by now. I don't see the banner of the House of Dawn. Queen Teleria taught me it's a courtesy for a Krantif noble to fly the golden sunburst of dawn when one of the royal house visits him. Fluter, true enough in ordinary circumstances, but Gwydion doesn't really want anybody to know he's there. He's told Smoit to put aside all the formalities. The most sensible precaution. I allow me. Yes, of course. I shouldn't have thought of that. How clever of you, Fluter. He beams. Experience, princess. Long experience. Never such wisdom will come to you. In other words, you're just a stupid girl. He is a king, after all, remember. So he understands a little bit about putting formalities aside. She goes, but the gates are closed. Knowing Smoit, wouldn't you think he'd have an honor guard out there and he'd be at the front of them? Fluter, nah. I've been on 1,000 secret missions. No, I understand what you think. Oh, yeah, I'm sure you do. You're so much smarter than I am. Golly gee. But King Smoit isn't at war with the neighbors. I mean, you'd think he'd only have a couple of watchmen on the walls. Instead, what is there? There's a whole party of bowmen. So, front gates are closed. Party of bowmen on the top. He says, well, of course, to protect Lord Gwydion. But if no one knows Gwydion's there, great villain, now you make my head spin. In other words, damn it, woman, shut up. Okay. What's she doing? She's pointing out a whole bunch of things that don't add up. She's counted 4 of them at least.
Red flag.
Yeah. And Fluter's like, no.
Look, kind of indicate how she's been affected by staying in the castle. She's like been...
Okay,
like,
yeah.
Tempered.
But it's also an indication of how Ilonwy is told later on by somebody that she sees, but not with her eyes. She perceives, she understands things from her heart, okay? She says, I don't know, but this isn't right, okay? So, Rune says, well, I'll just march right in. She goes, no. Fluter, I'll go in. I'm just a wandering bard. They won't expect anything. I'll go in, I'll take a look around, I'll come back out. He goes in, he takes a look around, he doesn't come right back out. Page 57, nightfall comes. She says it's all wrong. Rune, well, perhaps not. I mean, he'd have come back immediately if there was something to warn us about. Like he got in there and there's all bad guys and he's like, okay, see you later. No. But Fluter does come back. He tells him about Mag. Ilonwy catches Gwystl. Okay. And so they've got to put together a plan. What do they finally make Gwystl reveal about himself? Yeah, he's like, guys, you used to be able to find a time in a Times Square in New York. You could walk in, when I was in New York in 95, back before it was cleaned up, you could walk down the street and there'd be guys in trench coats and they'd do this. No, they weren't flashing you. They'd do this and you'd see everything they were selling lying on the inside of their coats. Okay? But he's not selling, he's just carrying. Armed to the teeth, essentially. Okay. He's got smoke bombs, fire bombs, and bombs that stop you from being able to see anymore. Okay. Takes a lot of time talking all this out of him. So, let's see here. I'm skipping a bunch. They come up with a plan. And Fluter says, let me return to the castle since they know me. He says, I'll have eggs and mushrooms, page 67. And the rest of you come over the back. Okay. And Rune says, wait a second. If you throw off the smoke bombs, we're not going to see where we're going. That's not a very good plan. Okay. So Rune comes up with his own plan, page 69. Some of you climb in over the castle wall in the back. Fluter Flam will have already gotten the gates open. He says, then while the others attack from the far wall, I shall ride straight through the gates. His hand goes to his sword, his head thrown back, okay, golden hair streaming in the wind produced by the fans for the film. And Rune, Arlanwy says, no, you can't do that. No, you need to stay back where it's safe. And he's like, why? Is she doing this because he's an idiot?
No.
No. You're not a prince anymore. Page 69. You're a king of Mona. Your life isn't altogether your own, don't you see? What does she mean?
Something happens to them, something happens to the whole kingdom. They lost their kingdom.
You belong to your people, she's saying. You have a whole realm of people to think of. We shan't let you take any more risks than you have to. You'll be in far too much danger as it is. I mean, if your mother heard about this. She says, if your mother knew what was going on, you wouldn't have sailed to Cair Dalman in the first place. He says, I don't know what mother has to do with anything. I'm sure my father would have wanted. Your father would have understood what it means to be a king. You must learn as well. Kings don't get a ride forward into battle. Think of the difference it would have meant in 1944, June 6th. If Eisenhower had been on one of those front planes jumping out with the 101st or the 82nd Airborne. Yeah, because he wouldn't be in the rear to be able to guide all those movements from that point on. And it was his tactical brilliance, his and Patton's and Bradley's and all the other generals, that enabled the West to win, okay? Kings can't do things like that. Kings have got to think first and foremost of what? Their kingdom, not themselves. Themselves is all about all glory. No. So, what does Terran have to think about? Himself? No. The people who will fight with him and under him. He says, Terran saved my life. I owe a debt to him. She says, you owe another kind of debt to the fisher folk of Mona, and their debt is the greater claim. You are their king. Terran's your friend. I honor you for your debt. It's good that you want to pay him back. You're learning. Again, he's showing his honor here. Okay? So, the battle starts. And what happens? Everything blows up. It just goes wrong from the beginning. Arlanwy rescues Smoid, Kahl, Terran, Gwydion, Gurgi. Fluter finds himself in the midst of a mess. Page 76 and 77. Terran and the others, they're making their way towards the gate. And Meg's men kind of overwhelm. They're trying to get out the gate to run, to get free. Meg's men overwhelm, so they can't get through. They're woefully outnumbered. There's, what, six of them? Mm-hmm. Plus Smoit's men that are still alive. Middle of 77. Suddenly, a mounted figure galloped into the courtyard. It was Rune, astride his dapple gray. The king of Mona's boyish face shone with a furious light. As the steed reared and plunged, Rune swung his sword about his head. You know, he's thinking of the film. And shouted at the top of his voice. Bowmen, follow me, all of you, into the court. Okay, first of all, Bowmen would be stupid to follow a guy into... Anyways. His words sprang above the clash of arms. Spearmen, this way, make haste. Terran, he's brought help. Notice, fooled him. Fluter, there's no one within miles. It won't work. Okay, Fluter is quintessentially... The glass is always half empty. He's not positive. He's not optimistic. He's kind of like glue. Not nearly as bad. In fact, what you see is you see this nice little kind of spectrum of kingship that Terran is kind of torn between. Rune at the bottom, moron, idiot, learning how to be a king. Fluter, already a king. How seriously does he take his kingship? He's never there. He's like Richard the Lionheart. Okay? King for 10 years in England in the late 12th century. Of that 10 years, he spent 6 months in London. 6 months. Whole rest of the time, off fighting the Crusades. And then you have Gwydion. Gwydion is the ideal. Okay? Terran's torn kind of between these. Or maybe he's starting a progression. So, what do we see? Terran says, it does work. It is working. Fluter, middle of 78. He's duped them well. For all the good those eggs and mushrooms did, it was Rune who turned the trick. And the next thing we hear, he's badly hurt. Page 79. Terran goes to Rune. He sees the arrow sticking in his side, the shaft broken off. A lot of blood. He's going to die. His face is deathly white. Deathly white always tells you. Yeah. Terran says, the day is ours. Without you, it would have gone differently. Amazing. I've never been in battle before. Or anything like it. Oddest things running through my mind. I was thinking of that stupid sea harp. Fluter comes in and says, oh, man, the bards are going to sing of you. And Terran cuts him off. The king of Mona is dead. That's our first real death, so to speak. Okay? How many of you foresaw for being introduced to King Rune as Prince Rune in the third book to this? What's he doing? What has he just done? He sacrificed himself. Did he know that's what he was doing? We can't guarantee that he did. Did he know there were bowmen and archers behind him? Bowmen and spearmen behind him? Yes, he knew there was nobody there. He does that all by himself. And what does he do? He draws all the attention to him and pulls it off of the others. He sacrifices himself and gives Gwydion, Terran, Kahl, Smoit what? Time to prevail. And for the Battle of Prydain, their first little victory. Okay? Dies in the process. It sucks. That's what Terran meant when he thought earlier about going off, because the life of one man, he says, is a very high price. So what do? They bury him, and the men get on horseback, and they circle his burial mound, singing a dirge. Okay? Yeah. We're going to pick up with the last two pages of that chapter on Tuesday and then go on. We're going to try to finish High King on Tuesday, but I don't think we will. Okay? Quiz will be Thursday because of that.